Veterans History Project collections are used by researchers the world over to explore a vast array of questions and topics. While many people access collections online via our website, others conduct on-site research in the American Folklife Center Reading Room. One such researcher is Dr. Susan Carruthers, a professor of history at the University of Warwick in the UK, who has utilized VHP collections for two different scholarly books, including a recently published volume on the history of Dear John letters, entitled Dear John, Love and Loyalty in Wartime America.
They're told in every conceivable different register, from the very heartrendingly tragic to the humorous.
We put together this video to give you a sense of Dr. Carruthers' research process using VHP collections in our reading room. Because we couldn't conduct a face-to-face interview in the reading room, we decided to transcend space and time through this video.
Hello, everyone. My name is Megan Harris, and I'm the reference specialist for the Veterans History Project. And I'll be speaking today with Dr. Susan Carruthers about her research process. And then we'll listen to a Dear John anecdote that she found particularly memorable. So for those of you who aren't familiar with the term, a Dear John letter is a breakup letter sent by a serviceman or woman to their sweetheart to inform them that the relationship is over. Hi, Susan. Thanks so much for joining me today, and congratulations on your new book.
Thank you. It's really nice to see you, Megan, albeit at a transatlantic remove. And I wish I could be in the reading room to have this conversation and record this face-to-face, but here I am in the UK.
How did you become interested in Dear John letters to start?
I read hundreds, literally hundreds of private correspondences between service personnel and their loved ones, including some that you pointed me to yourself. And I just became really fascinated by, even though these individuals were being censored, particularly those in uniform, I mean, they knew that their commanding officer was going to read their letters, were nevertheless very candid about everything that made sustaining a romantic connection really difficult, perhaps especially fearfulness about infidelity and whether their partner would be waiting for them faithfully when they got home. So, of course, the icon, the emblem of lack of fidelity, lack of loyalty in wartime is the Dear John letter. I guess perhaps the most naive idea I had about Dear John letters was that I would find some in archives. And I probably should have been smarter about this and thought myself into the shoes of the typical recipient of a Dear John letter, because it doesn't really take very much imagination to appreciate that most guys, when they have just received word that they have been dumped by their girlfriend or fiance or wife, do not cling on to that letter and cherish it and then later bequeath it to an archive for people like me to go and look at. What I ended up doing, and this is where your collection and your particular expertise came in, was to appreciate that actually most of what we know about Dear John letters is not because they exist in profusion in archives. What we have instead are hundreds of stories that veterans have told about Dear John letters, the women who sent them, how they're written, and so on. So this is why the Veterans History Project was so useful to me, because I was able, with your help, to find so many different servicemen, and in some cases women, because they got Dear Jane letters too, talking about that experience or a buddy's experience. So the book is really both about letter writing, but it's also about the stories that people tell about letters.
What was your experience in the reading room like?
Well, I would have to say, for anyone who hasn't visited you in person, that the experience of using the Veterans History Project collections is very different from using that magnificent rotunda that probably everyone knows at least by sight from photos. It's very cozy. It's very intimate. You have your own booth in which to sit with headphones on and listen to tape recorded material. So I had a fantastic time there, in part because you do have a much cozier workplace and you have your own little space in which to listen to and watch, in some cases, those recorded oral histories, but also your colleagues, because it's nested within the American Folklife Center. I can't stress strongly enough just how critical it is, how much richer and how much more you get out of an oral history if you're able to listen to it and watch it, because tone of voice matters tremendously. You can glean a lot from the context, from the setting in which an interview might be being conducted, all of these contextual prompts and audible prompts that are, of course, of necessity, just missing completely from a transcript. I am a big proselytizer on behalf of going to the archive and spending time there, and you will get so much more from the experience.
Are there any particular stories that stand out in your mind from the
Absolutely. I mean, one of the biggest discoveries was that Dear John's stories come in so many different guises. They're told in every conceivable different register, from the very heartrendingly tragic to the humorous. And I think that's what I didn't expect at all. It's easy to imagine that, of course, many men, even in hindsight, decades perhaps after the event, would tell aggrieved and angry stories about being broken up with. I was not expecting that so many of the stories would be funny. And there was one in particular that had this comic twist at the end that actually made me laugh out loud. And even though I've been going to historical archives for at least 30 years by now in my career, I don't remember ever actually laughing out loud before. This was a story told by a guy called Jared Streelman.
I'd like to play that clip that you're referring to, just so our viewers have a sense of what exactly made you laugh out loud.
There's another comical story I could tell you about that Dear John stuff that happened later. But guy told me, guy got a letter, Dear John, and said, been a long time since we've seen you. Said, in the meantime, I got acquainted with your dad. And I've been going out with him once in a while. And we got married. And she signed a letter, Dear Mother. That's, of course, a joke. I'm not sure that happened, but 20 things did happen in the war. And, but anyway, that was quite a story for a while.
Quite a story, indeed.
For more than a while, yes. Yeah, and one of the things that, just for anyone watching this, I think is worth stressing, which isn't clear just from listening to this, but you are actually hearing Jared telling this story to his own son. And I think that's another delightful twist in this. This is a story about a young GI overseas being betrayed by his dad. And there is a dad relaying this humorous anecdote to his son all those decades after the event. So I love that, and it made me laugh all over again. So thank you, Megan, for allowing me to recapture the first fine, careless rapture of hearing it on site.
Thank you so much for chatting, Susan. It's been a real pleasure both to chat with you today as well as to work with you on this research. And if anyone out there is watching and has a research interest of your own, we would absolutely love for you to come get in touch with us and come to our reading room and check it out. Thank you so much once again, Susan. It's been an absolute pleasure, and we hope to welcome you back to the reading room when you do your research for your next book. Thanks again.
I can't wait to get back.